back. Last class we discussed what is vapor pressure, what are the factors affecting vapor pressure, Raoult's law for volatile solutes and for non-volatile solutes, and what is meant by colligative properties, and what are the different types of colligative properties. So last class we have also discussed the relative lowering vapor pressure is a colligative property. Now here we are going to discuss the other colligative properties. Let us start the first one, that is elevation in boiling point. Elevation in boiling points. Okay, so what is boiling point? So boiling point is the temperature at which the vapor pressure of a solvent, of a liquid, becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure. Okay, so any substance which has lower vapor pressure, that has higher boiling point, and any substance which has higher vapor pressure has lower boiling point. So the boiling point is the temperature at which the vapor pressure of a liquid becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure. Okay, so here we have taken the vapor pressure and here we have taken the temperature. Temperature in x-axis and vapor pressure in y-axis. So in this way, so this is the temperature at which, and suppose this is the atmospheric pressure. This is atmospheric pressure. So the temperature at which the vapor pressure of a liquid becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure is known as its boiling point. So if some non-volatile solute is added to a solvent, so a solution is made of some non-volatile solute, then what happens to its vapor pressure? Then its vapor pressure decreases. So if we add some non-volatile solute to a solvent, then its vapor pressure decreases. Suppose this is the vapor pressure of a pure solvent, that is V naught, and this is the vapor pressure of a solution at a particular temperature. And when the again we know, as the temperature increases, then the vapor pressure increases. In this way, the vapor pressure increases for the solvent and it reaches at this temperature. Okay, so this is the boiling point of pure solvent. This is the boiling point of pure solvent. So this is solvent and this TB naught, this is the boiling point of pure solvent. And at the same time, the vapor pressure of, at the same temperature, the vapor pressure of the solution is always less than that of pure solvent. If some non-volatile solute is added there, so if this non-volatile solute is added there, then it has less vapor pressure. And as the temperature increases, its vapor pressure also increases, and it reaches, and the solution reaches at a at atmosphere pressure at a higher temperature. Okay, so this is suppose P1. This is P1. Okay, so P0 is the vapor pressure of pure solvent and P1 is the vapor pressure of solution. This is vapor pressure of this is the curve for solution. With increase in temperature, its vapor pressure increases. Suppose this is the vapor pressure of solution and it reaches at the atmospheric pressure at a higher temperature than that of the pure solvent. This is TB1. Okay, so where P0, that is your vapor pressure of pure solvent, and P1, that is the vapor pressure of solution. The solution has always lower vapor pressure than that of pure solvent, and T naught B. This is the boiling point of solvent. Boiling point of solvent and T B dash. This is the boiling point of solution. Boiling point of solution. Okay, so this is the boiling point of solution. In this way, here from this graph, and this is your atmospheric pressure. Atmospheric pressure, and here we see at every point the boiling point of solution is less than that of the vapor pressure. At every point, the boiling point of the vapor pressure of the solution is less than that of the pure solvent, and it reaches here. So in this way, the boiling point of solution is higher than that of the pure solvent. So this increase in the boiling point of this increase in the boiling point of a solution by adding the non-volatile solute is known as elevation in boiling point. Okay, so the elevation in boiling point, elevation in boiling point, that is del T B equal to T B dash minus T B zero. Okay, so this difference in boiling point of solution and the solvent is known as elevation in boiling point. Okay, so here we see the vapor pressure decreases and its boiling point increases. That means, so this change in vapor pressure, this change in small change in this boiling point depends on the small decrease in vapor pressure. Okay, so from this graph, it is concluded that the small change in temperature, the boiling point temperature, is the small change in vapor pressure. That is, increase in boiling point, increase in boiling point is related to decrease in vapor pressure. Decrease in vapor pressure. So increase in boiling point is related to decrease in vapor pressure. In this same, we can write del T B, the change in boiling point is a function of del P. The small change in boiling point is proportional to the small change in vapor pressure. So this is known as your elevation in boiling point. Okay, so del T B proportional to del P. Suppose this is your equation 1. And again, from Raoult's law, we also know del P is proportional to XB, or we can write X2. Del P is proportional to X2. What is X2? The X2, mole fraction of solute, where X2 is the mole fraction of solute. So del T V proportional to del P, again del P proportional to H2. So from these two relation, this is the equation 2, from these two relation we can find that del T V is proportional to H2. This del T V is also proportional to the mole fraction of solute. Okay, or del T V equal to some constant K into H2. Del T V equal to some constant K into H2. So what is the mole fraction? Suppose we substitute the formula of this mole fraction here. So what we found? Or del TP equal to K into moles of, that is the moles of solute by moles of solute plus moles of solvent. And for very dilute solution, N2 can be neglected from the denominator. This N2 can be neglected from the denominator. And this equation becomes del TB equal to K N2 by N1, or that is equal to K weight of solute by molecular mass of solute into molecular mass of solvent by weight of solvent. So W2, what is W2? This is your weight of solute. N2 is the number of moles of solute. N1, number of moles of solvent. Similarly, W2, this is the weight of solute, this is the molecular mass of solute, this is the molecular mass of solvent, and this is the weight of solvent. Okay, so this is equal to K into M1 into W2 by M2 into 1 by W1. So this K into M1 give rise to another constant, that is known as your KB into W2 and W2 by M2 into 1 by W1. So this K into M1 give rise to another constant. So this value W2 by M2 into 1 by W1, W2 by N2 into 1 by W1 is, this is known as another constant. So this is, sorry, this Kb into W2 by M2 into 1 by W1. So this term is known as your molality in weight of, in number of moles per kg. So this is known as your molality. So this term is known as molality. Hence, the equation becomes del Tb equal to Kb into molality. Del Tb equal to Kb into molality, where M equal to molality, that is number of moles per kg of solvent. Number of moles per kg of solvent. So this is an equation 3. Del T B equal to K B W2 by L2 1 by W1. Okay. So when M equal to 1 molar, then del T B equal to K B, and this K B is known as a constant. This K B is known as a constant, known as molar elevation constant. This is a constant known as molar elevation constant. Hence, molar elevation constant is equal to the elevation in boiling point. Molar elevation constant is equal to the elevation in boiling point when the strength of the solution, or the, when the solution is of strength 1 molar. Or when del Tb equal to Kb, or molar elevation constant is equal to the elevation in boiling point of 1 molar solution. This is called molar elevation constant, also known as your ebullioscopic constant. This is also known as molar elevation constant, or ebullioscopic constant. Okay, so del Cb equal to Kb into M. This is suppose equation 4. And here the molality is taken in number. weight of the solvent taken in gram. If the weight of the solvent taken in grams, then this equation 3 becomes del Tb equal to Kb into W2 by M2 into 1000 by Wn. So if this is taken in gram, if weight is taken in gram, then you have to multiply your 1000, and if this is taken in kg, then this is taken in this. Okay, another thing, so del Tb equal to Kb and Kb equal to molar elevation constant. This is equal to the depression, so this is equal to the elevation in boiling point when the solution have concentration 1 molar. Okay, so in this case, what is the unit of Kb? So this Kb, you know, del Tb equal to Kb into M. So Kb equal to del Tb by M, del Tb by M. As Kb equal to del Tb by M, so this is your unit is Kelvin, and molality kg per, sorry, moles per kg. In this way, unit of Kb, unit of Kb, what is that term? That is equal to del Tb by M, that is Kelvin, kg, mole inverse, Kelvin, kg, mole inverse. Okay, so Kelvin, and this is equal to mole per kg, moles per kg in this way. This is Kelvin, Kelvin, and this is mole per kg. In this way, this unit is Kelvin, kg, mole inverse. Kelvin, kg, mole inverse. So the unit of Kb is Kelvin, kg, mole inverse. It depends on the nature of solvent. It depends on the nature of solvent. Okay, and another thing, this del Tb is also a colligative property. This elevation in boiling point is a colligative property. From this equation 4, we know del Tb equal to Kb into M. As del Tb equal to Kb, this is a constant, depends on the nature of solvent. And M, this is the molality of solute. As it is molality of solute, means number of moles per kg of solvent. As it depends on the number of moles, or it depends on the number of particles of the solute, number of moles of the solute, number of particles of the solute. Hence, it is a colligative property. So, as del Tb depends on number of moles of solute, or it depends on number of particles of the solute, particles of solute, hence it is a colligative property. It is a colligative property. Okay, next, the molecular mass of the solute can be found out from this elevation in boiling point. So how much temperature increases, from this we can calculate what is the molecular mass of solute. So look here, in this equation, del Tb equal to Kb W2 M2 1000 by W1. So del Tb, this is the elevation boiling point, Kb molar elevation constant, and W2, this is the weight of solute, molecular mass of solute, this is the weight of solvent. In this case, what is the value of M2? The value of M2 equal to Kb W2 1000 by del Tb into W1. So in this way, we can determine what is the molecular mass of solute. So there are different factors, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, sum of the five factors. Among the five factors, if any four factors are given, then we can calculate the another. Now, next comes to another factor, another colligative property, that is depression in freezing point. Depression in freezing point. Okay, so as some non-volatile solute is added to a solvent, its boiling point increases. Similarly, if some non-volatile solute is added to a solvent, then its freezing point decreases. That means if we add suppose glucose, or we add sugar, or we add salt to water, then its freezing point decreases. Its boiling point also increases, that is called elevation in boiling point. Similarly, its freezing point decreases. So this freezes at a lower temperature than that of normal water. So when a non-volatile solute is added to a solvent, then its freezing point decreases. So this decrease in freezing point is known as depression in freezing point. So actually, what is freezing point? So freezing point is a temperature at which both the liquid and solid coexist and both have the same vapor pressure. Okay, so freezing point is a temperature at which a liquid just starts to freeze, or this is the temperature also at which a solid just starts to melt. Okay, so here the solid as well as the liquid both coexist and both have same vapor pressure. Okay, suppose we draw a graph between vapor pressure and temperature. Here temperature and here vapor pressure, and this is the curve for a solvent. Okay, this is the curve for a solvent. So by decreasing temperature, suppose the solvent reaches, this is the line for solid. So this is for solid, so this is the curve for solvent, and here it starts solid. So this is solid solvent. So this one is solid solvent, and in this case this is liquid solvent. So both have same vapor pressure. And you know, if some volatile solute, some non-volatile solute, if some non-volatile solute is added to a solvent, then its vapor pressure decreases. So in liquid form, its vapor pressure decreases. This is the vapor pressure of a solution. Okay, and it also decreases. So actually, the solute remains as such, but the solvent actually undergo freeze. So in this way, it reaches here. Okay, so this is the temperature for, this is the solution. This is for solution. Okay. Parallel line. Okay, so this is the curve for solution. This is the curve for solution, and this is the curve for solvent. The solvent reaches at solid in this temperature. So solvent reaches here. Okay, so this is the temperature. Suppose this is TF naught. Temperature increases in this way, vapor pressure increases in this way. This is TF naught. This is the freezing point of pure solvent. And at every point, the solution has a lower vapor pressure than that of the pure solvent. So in this way, it reaches to a solid state at a lower temperature. So when we draw the curve, so it reaches the solid state. The solution reaches the solid state at the lower temperature than that of pure solvent, and this is for PO. Okay, so this is for TF1. Okay, this is the vapor pressure liquid solvent. This is the vapor pressure curve of solvent, and this is the vapor pressure curve of solution. And in here, what we find from this curve, it is also we find that this decrease in freezing point also depends on this decrease in vapor pressure. This decrease in freezing point also depends on the decrease in vapor pressure. Okay, so if some non-volatile solute is added to a solvent, then its vapor pressure decreases and it reaches to a solid state at a lower temperature than that of the pure solvent. So this decrease in freezing point of the solution, this decrease in freezing point of the solution is known as depression in freezing point. Okay, so TF0, this is the freezing point of pure solvent, and TF1 freezing point of solution. Then del TF, this is equal to TF0 minus TF dash. So del TF, this is the decrease in freezing. TF0 minus TF dash, this is known as your depression in freezing point. Depression in freezing point. So this is the depression in freezing point. Okay, so again we know this del TF is related to del P. That means the small change in freezing point all depends on the small change in vapor pressure. The small change in freezing point depends on the small change in vapor pressure. In this way, del TF is proportional to del P. Okay, so this is equation 1. And again from Raoult's law, del TP proportional del P, the lowering in vapor pressure is equal to, the lowering in vapor pressure is proportional to H2. What is H2? This is mole fraction of solute. H2, this is the mole fraction of the solute. Okay, so del P proportional to H2, del T proportional to del P. So from these two relation we find del TF proportional to del TF proportional to H2. And again, as you have, or we can say del TF some constant K into H2. So as you have derived, in case of elevation in freezing point, so elevation in boiling point, here also we can relate it, del TF equal to M into KF into H2. Okay, one thing, K into H2, number of moles of this by N1 plus N2. This is the similar way, as that is equal to N2 by N1. This is for very dilute solution. For very dilute solution, K L2 by N1, that is equal to K W2 by M2, weight of solute by molecular mass of solute into molecular mass of solvent by weight of solvent. And this is equal to K M1 W2 M2 1 by W1. This K gives rise to another constant that is called Kf and W2, and this term is known as molality, that is equal to m. So del Tf equal to Kf into m. Okay, so this is equation 3. Okay, so again, what is this Kf? This Kf is called molar depression constant. Okay, what is this Kf? Kf is called molar depression constant. This is called molar depression constant, also called cryoscopy constant. Cryoscopy constant. Cryoscopic constant. Okay, this Kf is called cryoscopy constant or molar depression constant. And when m equal to 1 molar, then del Tf equal to Kf. That means molar depression constant is equal to the depression in freezing point. Molar depression constant is equal to the depression in freezing point of 1 molar solution. Or when the concentration of the solution is 1 molar, then the Kf equal to del Tf. Or molar depression constant is equal to the depression in freezing point when the concentration of the solution is 1 molar. Okay? So if this is given, del Tf equal to Kf into m, and here del Tf K m1 W2 by m2 is given, or we can write del Tf equal to Kf into W2 by m2 into 1 by WR in kg. When this is given, when the weight of solvent given in kg, then del Tf equal to this much. If this is given, if the weight of this solvent is given in gram, then this equation changes. Del Tf, this is equation 4. Okay. Then del Tf equal to Kf into W2 by M2 into 1000 by W1 in gram. When it is given in gram, then you should multiply by 1000, and when it is given in kg, then 1 by W1. So this is the relationship between del Tf and molality of the solution. Okay. So now this del Tf is also a colligative property. How this del Tf is a colligative property? Look here in equation 3. In this equation 3, del Tf equal to Kf into m. But this Kf is what is? This is molar depression constant. It also depends on the nature of solvent. It depends on the nature of solvent. It is independent of number of particles of the solute. Okay? And del Tf is proportional to molality of the solution. Del Tf proportional to molality of this solute. Molality of the solution means number of moles of the solute. So del Tf proportional to m, that means del Tf depends on number of moles of solute, number of moles of solute or number of particles of solute. It depends on number of moles of the solute or number of particles of the solute. Hence, del Tf is a colligative property. Hence, it is a colligative property. Okay? Next, the molecular mass of the solute can be easily determined from this depression in freezing point. Look here there. So m2 equal to Kf into W2 into 1000 by del Tf into W1 in gram. Okay, so the molecular mass of a solute experimentally can be determined from depression in freezing point. Okay, so this is another colligative property. Now comes to another colligative property, that is osmotic pressure. Another colligative property, that is osmotic pressure. So before going osmotic pressure, you should know what is osmosis. So osmosis is a process by which the solvent molecules can pass through a solvent to solution, or from a low concentration to high concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. Okay, so the process by which the solvent molecules, not the solute particles, the solvent molecules can pass through, so the solvent molecule can pass from a low concentration to high concentration, or from a solvent to a solution through a semi-permeable membrane. Some resins are soaked in water, then it swells up. So that is due to this osmosis process. So in the resins, in dry resins, the inside the concentration is high, but in outside water is there, the concentration is low. In this way, water, the solvent, pass through the semi-permeable membrane, through its covering. And what are the semi-permeable membrane? The semi-permeable membrane, that may be natural or that may be artificial semi-permeable membrane. So generally, natural semi-permeable membranes are vegetable membranes or animal membranes, and the artificial membranes are cupric ferrocyanides or silicates of some iron, nickel, etc. are used as artificial semi-permeable membrane, through which only solvent molecules can pass, but the solutes cannot be passed. Okay, so that process is known as osmosis. Suppose you have taken a container and there are two openings there. Okay, you have taken a container and two openings, two tubes are there, and these two are separated by a semi-permeable membrane. That is artificial semi-permeable membrane. This is the semi-permeable membrane, and this side we have, okay, and here we have taken a piston, a frictionless piston. Okay, so here suppose solvents are there, and here solution is there. Here some solvent is present and here solution present. Okay, so if solvent is present, so and these two liquids are separated by a semi-permeable membrane, then after some time we can observe this level generally increases. So the level of this liquid level generally increases and this liquid level generally decreases. From which what we conclude? From which conclude the solvent molecules can pass to the solution through the semi-permeable membrane. The solvent molecules pass to the solution, goes to the solution through this semi-permeable membrane. So that process is known as osmosis. So if after some time this process stops, after this time this flow of solvent molecules stops, after some time the flow of solvent molecules stops, that means there arises some pressure on this way. Okay, or just by adding putting some solutions here and some solvents here. Suppose we apply some pressure here. So that no flow of solvent molecules takes place from solvent to solution. So the maximum pressure which can be applied from the solution side, to prevent the flow of solvent molecules through this semipermeable membrane is known as osmotic pressure. That is known as your osmotic pressure. So what is osmotic pressure? The osmotic pressure is the maximum pressure that is applied on solution side. So that it can prevent the flow of solvent. From the solvent to solution is known as osmotic pressure. And this osmotic pressure has similar behavior as that of the gaseous pressure. So in this way, not to confuse with this gaseous pressure, this osmotic pressure is generally represented by letter pi. So what is osmotic pressure? The maximum pressure that can be applied from the solution side so that it can check or prevent the flow of solvent molecules from low concentration to high concentration or from the solvent to the solution is through the semipermeable membrane. Is known as osmotic pressure, and its behavior is similar like that of atmosphere pressure. So Van 't Hoff experienced so many experiments. And formulated some laws regarding this osmosis process, and that are known as your Van 't Hoff law. As these are similar to that of the gaseous law, in this way Van 't Hoff law is also included with this gaseous laws. So first come to Van 't Hoff Boyle's law. Maximum experiments were done by Van 't Hoff regarding this osmosis. And formulated some laws that are known as Van 't Hoff laws. So Van 't Hoff Boyle's law. So this law states that at constant temperature, the pressure of the osmotic pressure is directly proportional to the concentration of the solution. Okay, so pi is proportional to C. That is the concentration. What is C? C is concentration of solution. To it, we can represent number of moles per liter, or number of moles per V ml of or V liter of solution. Pi is proportional to C at constant temperature. Similarly, another law, that is Van 't Hoff Gay-Lussac's law. So this law states that at constant concentration, if the concentration is kept constant, if the concentration remains constant, then the osmotic pressure is directly proportional to the temperature of this solution. So according to Van der Waals's law, pi is proportional to T, constant what? At constant C, at constant the concentration constant, then pi proportional to T. Suppose this is equation 2 and this is equation 1. Okay, so from this equation 1 and 2, combining this is equation 1 and 2, what we get? Pi proportional to C into T, or pi equal to some constant R C T. Okay, so what is this R? This R is called solution constant. Solution constant, and it has the same value as that of gaseous constant, 0.0821 liter atmosphere Kelvin inverse mole inverse. This is the value of R. Okay, so this is equation 3, and this equation 3 can be written as pi equal to, as C equal to N by V. So substituting this value, R N T by V. Okay, so this is the similar equation as PV equal to NRT, similarly pi V equal to NRT. Okay, so this is the equation for, this is the equation for osmotic pressure. So, or you can say pi equal to NRT by V. Pi equal to NRT by V. So this equation is known as Van der Waals equation, and this is useful for, and this is useful to determine the osmotic pressure. Now, the osmotic pressure is also a colligative property. Okay, the osmotic pressure is also a colligative property. So how we can determine the osmotic pressure is a colligative property? Look, N is number of moles of the solute, concentration, C represents the concentration, that is number of moles per liter of the solution, and N is the number of moles. N is the number of moles means, number of moles of solute means weight of the solute divided by its molecular mass. In this way, pi equal to weight by molecular mass R T by V. So R is universal gas constant, V is the volume of solution, okay, M is the molecular mass. If the T is remain constant, if we take a constant temperature, then pi depends on weight of solute. As pi depends on, so this is equation 1. As pi, the osmotic pressure depends on weight of the solute, as it depends on the weight of the solute, that is number of particles of the solute, weight of the solute, or you can say number of moles of the solute. As pi depends on number of moles of the solute, or as pi depends on weight of the solute, or the number of particles of the solute, hence it is a colligative property. Is a colligative property. Okay, so it is a colligative property. Similarly, the molecular mass of the solute can also determine from osmotic pressure. So what is M? So M equal to WRT by pi V. So the molecular mass of the solute can be determined from the osmotic pressure. So there are four processes by which we can determine the molecular mass, that is relative lowering in vapor pressure, that is elevation in boiling point, depression in freezing point, and another, that is your osmotic pressure. Among them, the most accurate method by which the molecular mass is determined, that is your by osmotic pressure. By osmotic pressure, the molecular mass of solute can easily determine. Another thing I want to say here, that is osmotic pressure, so depends on the concentration of the solution, and a solution which has higher osmotic pressure is known as hypertonic solution, and a solution which has lower osmotic pressure is known as hypotonic solution. Okay, so solution with high the solution with high osmotic pressure is known as hypertonic solution. And solution with low osmotic pressure known as hypotonic solution. And if the two solutions are same osmotic pressure, then that are known as isotonic solutions that have same pi value, same osmotic pressure. Always osmosis takes place from hypotonic solution to hypertonic solution. And in isotonic solution, no osmosis takes place. Okay. Now, let us work out some problems. So, starting from question number 3. Calculate the osmotic pressure at 273 Kelvin of a 5% solution of urea. So we know pi equal to n r t by v, and again n equal to we know w by m into r t by v. Okay, so 5% solution means 5 gram present in 100 ml of solution. Okay, so V equal to 100 ml and W equal to 5 gram, W equal to 5 gram. And as is given urea, urea has formula NH2CO NH2, so its molecular mass is 60 gram mole inverse. Gram molecular mass is 60, so its molecular mass 60 gram mole inverse. And T is given 273 Kelvin. Substitute these values. This is equal to W given 5 molecular mass 60 into R value given 0.0821 liter atmosphere Kelvin inverse mole inverse, and V is given 100 ml, that is equal to 0.1 liter, because we have taken in liter, liter atmosphere Kelvin inverse mole inverse, so 60 into 0.1. In this way we find this value is 18.68 atmosphere. So the value is, the osmotic pressure is 18.68 atmosphere. Just multiply and divide by 60, you can get the answer. Next, come to question number 2. Gram of ethylene glycol is mixed with 600 gram of water. So given W2 equal to 45 gram, W1 equal to 600 gram. And what is your ethylene glycol, the formula given? Then what is your M2? That is equal to CH2OH 12 plus 2 plus 1, 3 plus 16. So oxygen has 16, 3 hydrogen, in this way 3, and carbon has 12. So multiply this by 2. 21 into 2, that is equal to 62. So m2 equal to 62. Suppose m for gram mole inverse. 62 gram mole inverse. Okay, so this was given. Mixed system thermometer. Calculate the freezing point depression and then what is your del Tf? Del Tf equal to Kf into W2 by M2 into 1000 by W1. As weight given in gram, so I have taken 1000. Okay, so this value substitute and Kf given 1.86 Kelvin kg mole inverse into 45 divided by m2 62 into 1000 by 600. Okay, so this value you can get multiplying dividing can get 2.25 Kelvin. So del Tf equal to Kelvin, but we know the solvent is water, its freezing point is, the solvent is water, its Tf not is 273 Kelvin. So in this way, Tf1, that is the freezing point of solution, 273 minus 2.25, that is 270.75 Kelvin. Okay, so in this way you can find out what is the del Tf, and from this del Tf the freezing point of submersion, so this decreases. Next come to question number 1. So the boiling point of benzene is 353.23 Kelvin when 1.8 gram of non-volatile solute is dissolved in 90 gram of benzene. So one non-volatile solute W2 1.8 gram. Solute dissolved in W1 90 gram. Weight of solvent, weight of solute. The boiling point is rise to, so TB naught, that is equal to 353.23 Kelvin, and TB dash, that is equal to 354.11 Kelvin. So 354.11 Kelvin, 1.88 Kelvin. So del Tb equal to 1.88 Kelvin. So Tb dash minus Tb naught, you can find out Tb dash minus Tb naught. This is your del Tb. Calculate the molar mass of the solute. So for calculation of molar mass of the solute, m2 equal to Kb into W2 into 1000, Kb into W2 into 1000 into del Tb into W1, del Tb into W1. So Kb is given for benzene 2.53 and W2 have given 1.8 and 1000 divided by del Tb 1.88 into W1 given 90. Okay, so in this way whole inverse. Okay, so in this way we can solve different problems.